Good evening, everyone. Everyone can hear me? Good evening, I am Jan Keirse. I'm technical architect at TVH Part. On the corner is Tom De Smet, who will join me in 20 minutes. Together we will, Tom is the solution architect at TVH. For those who don't know TVH Parts, you've just been introduced to equipment. TVH Parts is a software company, and we use forklift parts and aerial platform parts as a means of monetization of our platform. Today we're going to talk to you about cloud computing, about microservices, and about our first experiences we have had with it, the struggles we've had, the advantages. The original intent of the talk was to have a really basic introduction for people who have never done anything with cloud computing, who have never used microservices. We've looked at the participants list, and we had the impression that there are quite a few people in the room that actually have already done things with it that are at some point. So it would be interesting for us to know, are there people here who have a lot of experience with cloud computing? You can just raise your hands. Yes, some. With microservices, a few, and okay, and with nothing at all. So okay, there's a basic level. We're going to try keep it interesting for everyone. So we have a fairly broad scope. We're going to explain you how we solved stuff, and we expect that other people will have had similar problems, maybe other solutions. There's not enough time to have too much conversation during the talk because there's so much and it's so broad. It will also be a bit high level. If you have questions, you can ask them after the talk. We will be around. It's lunch immediately after the talk, so you can come to us. If there's a subject you find very interesting and you would like us to have a talk about in more detail in the future, on an IT talk here or somewhere else, please do get in touch. We are very happy to oblige. A few months ago, I was at a conference, and between the talks, I was talking to a guy who was sitting next to me. No other colleague was present, they had to leave early. And the guy said, it's all very cool and it's all very interesting. And he said, yeah, I so wish I could use this. And he said, we are stuck with legacy, so the cloud is not for me. And it's a very interesting thing to say, because if you look at our code, I don't know about you guys, our oldest code in production is written in 1992. Don't know anyone else who has older code? Yes, okay, I see your pain. Anyone who has code, say, older than 10 years ago? 10 years ago, and that hasn't been touched. Okay. It can happen. We have it too. At the same time, we have state-of-the-art code. And there's no reason, especially if you are used to state-of-the-art code, but even if you are completely stuck and all you have is on technology that's been invented 15 years ago and that hasn't changed a bit in the way you work, even in that case, there is no reason to stay away from the cloud. The first thing we did was actually put that code that was from 1992 and put it on the cloud. There are a couple of ways to make that easy, and that's, for example, for batch processing, because you don't need real-time interaction with the existing code base or with the existing application on-premise that you will probably not want to immediately move. And an interesting thing is that it makes the impossible possible. Another thing that can be interesting is that, for example, if you have right now on-premise your solution, and maybe, if you're lucky, two or three environments to test, you may want to provide an environment for each developer, a complete setup of your entire system, and it may be impractical to do that on-premise. It's probably very easy to do that in the cloud. Those are just a few ideas. You could say, why would I move to the cloud? I'm happy with the way it works. This is the Google developer's cheat sheet. For the Google people, you are lucky, because you will always be first. That's because he deal with you. You're also unlucky because we know your problems. So you will also have less positive impact occasionally. So this is the Google developer cheat sheet. Anyone in the back who can read it? Anyone in the front who can read it? Probably not. Why is that? Because there's so much. There's an incredible amount of technology that's available. Some of it can be done. I won't lie. You can do big data on-premise. Anyone who has ever set up, a Hadoop cluster, you can do that on-premise, but it is a challenge. A lot of these things are possible, but they are very, very difficult on-premise. They are peanuts if you do them in the cloud, and I'm not really exaggerating here. If you go to a workshop, they can show you in a day how to do big data, how to do machine learning, how to do cloud computing, all in a single day, and you will understand. So this is the ecosystem for Google. You have something similar from Amazon. It's massive. I couldn't immediately find a cheat sheet for Microsoft, for IBM, but they also have huge or somewhat similar ecosystems. This is the cloud computing native, cloud compute. I've lost the word, sorry. The Cloud Native Compute Foundation, their ecosystem is just an immense amount of technology. All of this is available to you very easily. You don't have to use it, but you will die because your competitors also have access to it, and you can very quickly do a lot of things that if you don't do them, your problem. Another very good reason to move is the many doors. There's not a single way to move to the cloud. There are a lot. In the past, if you wanted, if as a department within your company, you wanted to start using some software, you always had to go through IT. IT was running the servers, IT was running the applications. Today, that's no longer true. If your sales department wants to start using Salesforce, they can. And the only thing they need is a Visa card, and you won't have to be in between. As an IT department, you probably do want to guide them. There is a lot of SaaS available. There is a lot of software in the cloud available. Some of them is super interesting and super performance and very good for your company, but there's also a bit of crap. And you want to be the one, because you're the only one who can, you want to be the one who opens the doors, who guides them through the process, and either you help them with it, or they will go behind you. Shadow IT in the past was a spreadsheet, it was an Access database, maybe, it was all fairly well contained. Today, that is no longer true. If you don't guide your people to the cloud, they will find their way and they will eliminate you. So, okay, interesting. I want to do this. Because you're all here, I expect that you already want to do this. Maybe your management does not want to do that. The first thing I moved to the cloud was an application that needed access to all the data of TVH. It basically was the monolith we had, so the 9 million lines of code. I wanted to run it in a scalable way, 100 instances of it. One instance runs on a server that's quickly going to €200,000 for one server. So if you want to run 100 of instances, you have a problem. The easiest way to get permission, to get all your secrets, all your company secrets in the cloud, is to offer a solution that you can provide in the cloud that's basically impossible on-premise. Nobody's going to pay €2 million for a single batch process. They will happily pay €2,000 for running the same thing in the cloud, for renting 6,400 cores, that's what we do, 6,400 cores for 2 hours every month. And the price for something like that is peanuts. Doing the same on-premise is basically impossible. Another question you are going to get asked, probably, and even today we get asked, yeah, what about security? And that's a very valid question. Cloud vendors make it very easy to start using the cloud. And as a result, any service you create on the cloud is accessible, probably immediately, without a single firewall. That means if, as a developer, you don't secure your stuff, the attack vector is no longer the people who can somehow get into your internal network, which is important, of course, and which you still have to secure. But the attack vector becomes the entire internet. There are fairly easy solutions. I know in Google, you can just firewall it out. And once you set up the proper networking settings, it is automatically firewalled out. And it becomes as if it was running internally behind the firewall. But you have to be aware of it. If you ignore it, you will most likely get burned. There are currently things in the news about people who are running MongoDBs on the cloud and they forget to reset the default password. Sorry, guys, you can just erase your database. Ha. If you are aware of these things, it's not so difficult to solve it. And then you get a different situation. Your security expert in your company, I hope he's good. I hope he's very good. How many people have more than 10 attacks a month? Maybe if there are banks, they could be. How many people have more than 10 a year on their company? If you are a big cloud vendor, one of the five big, or the four or five big, then you basically get attacked all day, multiple times, thousands of times, by private people, by companies, by governments, by... It's unimaginable. And the honor you are going to get within the criminal community for breaking into, say, Google or Amazon is significantly bigger than breaking into your own company. So it is fairly simple to accept that security, if you follow some basic guidelines, is a billion times better on the Google Cloud than within your own company, or in the Google any cloud. Just never forget the obvious things to take care of. So, okay, now you want to get started. What's an easy way to start with a legacy system? I'm really talking here about pure legacy systems, things that have been developed 20 years ago. What you can do is identify a list of candidates, choose things that can create huge value, and focus on things that are impossible. If you do that, impossible on-premise, if you do that, it's much easier to get permission than if you focus on, say, okay, it's going to be cheaper. Don't focus on cost. It's probably not the best reason to move to the cloud, even if it can be cheaper. An easy start, the thing we did, so we had a situation, our primary ERP software, the core of the company, is running on a single server with a 64 gigabyte of RAM, 64 cores. We had a process that we had to run, like for customers, a batch, and then the output was a list of details that I can't disclose. Anyway, the original process took 20 hours. What you do in a case like that, you start tuning, you start performance improvements. Eventually, I could get it to like 2-3 hours, but that was the absolute best I could get. Yes? And then we had a problem. We had to run that batch every month, and we had to do it not once, but for 100 different customers. So that means that we like could do it in 20 days, but we had to do it on the first of the month. We evaluated moving to another technology, rewriting everything, but we were looking at 9 million lines of code. We had 3 months to complete the project. In the end, I completed from the idea to implement it, I did it in a month. Basically, what we did was we took our original server, we reconfigured the exact same server on the cloud. We took a backup of our database, restored the database in the cloud. If you would want, you could actually continuously replay your after imaging logs or your transaction logs or whatever it's called in the database you have. And that way you have constantly an up-to-date database. And then when you want to start your script, you just set up the startup script of your server to that specific batch, that specific logic. And then with a simple script, you can clone your machine. A minute and you have an extra 2 minutes, you have two, sometimes in 10 minutes you have 20. So that's a way you could do it. This works at least for each x86 and x64 process. I think it's possible for iSeries on IBM, but we don't have experience. But we run proprietary. That means, yeah, your software is licensed per core. We had the same situation, and there the answer is really simple. You go to your vendor and you say, okay, we have this problem. We could license for like 100 times what we pay today. That's not going to happen. We have two options. We rewrite everything in an open technology and we say goodbye, or we come to an agreement. And any vendor that even has some feeling, he will do it for you, because otherwise he loses you as a customer in the long run. when we did this, we made some mistakes. So I will tell you them, and then you can learn from it, I hope. Hopefully, you are already automating deployment of your servers. If that's not the case, you have to start doing it for this. I set up this proof of concept, and I wanted to move fast, and I configured the server manually. And essentially, you have to start again doing it automatically, because it's difficult to keep these things up to date otherwise. What I also wanted to do was keep it generic. You probably already guessed that we're on Google Cloud mostly today. I wanted to be able to move. So I did everything with a generic tool called libcloud, and then you spend a lot of time making it generic, and if I would just have used the cloud-specific tools, it would have been very easy. And then if I would ever want to move, it would also be much easier to just rewrite those pieces in the other cloud solutions. There's a big aspect, and that is if the solution that you're looking at, the cloud that you're looking at, the tools don't provide what you want. There, I said there were going to be negative things too. For example, Stackdriver, it doesn't just provide the handling of your logs as the way you would like it, and then you have to look elsewhere. You can consider Kubernetes. It handles a lot of the automation process for you, like the scaling, stuff like that. But it can be difficult for legacy workloads because, for example, putting a 2 terabyte database in a pod, probably not the best idea. And then things that are very important, if you have machines that you create and that you delete after when they're done, monitoring becomes much more important. Don't forget to add log file parsing. You can't look at a log file for a machine that's no longer there. You can't look at performance for a machine that, that's no longer running, and it's very difficult to look at 100 machines at the same time. So you probably want a solution there. Most clouds have solutions, and there are other things there as well, but Tom will touch on that. Another interesting thing is money. The cloud is very cheap for doing things. However, it's very easy to start doing things and then forgetting about them. And if you're forgetting about a lot of things, then suddenly it becomes very easy to spend a lot of money on things that you're not actually using. So keep an eye on that. Keep an eye on what you're spending. If you're using, for example, BigQuery, just to say something, every query costs. Make sure that the people that do the queries know that they cost and that they are cheap on small data sets. They are not necessarily so cheap on big data sets, especially if you have 30 people doing queries like that all day long. Then the state of the cloud, that's an interesting thing. This is the evolution of let's say, computing. We are about here, and I'm not exaggerating. You will constantly feel when dealing with the cloud, am I really the only one who's doing this? We've encountered that a lot, and we go to talks, and we use best practices. We don't like experiment with things that are brand new. We choose the established solutions, and even in the established solutions, you sometimes encounter things where you think, what am I doing wrong? This is the best way to do it, and it just doesn't work. And then after a lot of searching, you find, OK, it's a bug. Happens. We recently had a situation where we simply couldn't pull containers. And we were looking for 3 days, why can't we pull containers from our container registry in Kubernetes? It was a bug in the API, apparently. And after long searching, we figured out there were a couple of other people that had the same. And then all of a sudden, the problem was solved. You encounter this, it doesn't mean that you shouldn't do it anyway. Because the gains are so big that you'll just have to live with it. What you will also see is that anything that's been said or done a year ago is no longer necessarily true. Things improve at a pace that's completely beyond what we are used to. In the past, big evolutions in IT happened every 10 years. Now they happen every 6 months. As a result, and as a result of the fact that since this is all so new and people are all struggling with the same problems, a lot of overlap is created. When you want to do canary testing, there are at least 4 different ways that are best practices to do canary testing. And you will encounter that in a lot of stuff. So it's something to keep an eye on. Working with the cloud, especially doing the investigation stuff, it requires a special kind of people. Not everyone likes all that digging. They get annoyed. They want to just deliver business value, not be figuring out how this thing that's supposed to be so great works because it doesn't. And for that, we have created the Cloud Squad. Basically, we see in other companies, they do the same. Our Cloud Squad, those are the guys that do the research on these things. Not that they have the exclusive right to do the research, we just make them permanently available for that. They do the research, they do the training of people, they explain to everyone what they have figured out, and they do, maybe they will run the Kubernetes cluster, but nothing else. The actually running of the application, that goes to the individual squads that do the programming. I'm running slightly out of time, so I'm going to increase the pace. Another thing, when you use the cloud, don't waste your time on running a database. You can have that managed. Don't waste your time on anything where you can't differentiate. There are not enough developers. There are not enough IT people. The time your own people spend, they have to spend on it on things where they can make a difference, not on a DBA that can, where any other DBA would replace him. It's probably something you don't want to do yourself. There are exceptions, and that's when you add your own value, when you're doing something really unusual, and then you may do it yourself. Or if the solution that's available, managed, just doesn't cut it, just doesn't do what you want. In that case, you can make exceptions. But default to running managed whenever possible. With that said, I now give the word to Tom.